Well, hello, hello, everyone. Welcome to enjoythemusic.tv and enjoythemusic.com live stream CES 2017. And we are here with Dan and Leo of SweetVinyl, who are going to tell us a little bit more about their SweetVinyl Sugar Cube. Whew. So, gentlemen, why don't you go ahead? Hi, Dan. Hi, Leo. How are you this morning?
We're doing great. How are you, Stephen?
Good, great. Just doing the whole CES thing. Now, you have this really successful campaign on Indiegogo. Why don't you tell everyone about what it is and how you're doing?
Yeah, great. Thanks, Stephen. Yeah, so we last year at CES, we showed a prototype of our SweetVinyl Sugar Cube for the first time, and we got a lot of very interested customers. We deleted the phono stage from it, and we put instead in place just a line-in, line-out, click-and-pop removal system that also records vinyl. It identifies metadata in real time, and it actually does track separation. It figures out the albums. It gives you essentially pristine digital high-res copies of a vinyl record in real time as you play them. So essentially, you can take your music and, as you would say, Stephen, enjoy the music from your vinyl record everywhere we go. So we did an Indiegogo campaign because Leo and I have funded the company ourselves. Leo is a technical founder. I'm the business guy at the company. We've been building it ourselves for about 3 years. Our background was that we were doing these master quality reverse pressings, what we call taking reverse masters of old vinyl pressings and making high-res files for the music industry. But we decided there wasn't really a good market to make money that way. So we decided that it would be much better to let people take their own vinyl records and to reproduce whatever quality of sound that they have in their home stereo system digitally with vinyl. So essentially that's what we did. The Indiegogo campaign is the culmination of those efforts to get us into beta test after we ship in the next few months both of these SC1 and SC2 products. We will then go into distribution in the US and around the world.
Well, that makes perfect sense. And judging from your Indiegogo, you're already 236% funded.
Correct.
So
this will represent our beta group of initial users. We don't want to get too crazy big. We want to be able to have a successful launch and support this group with a new category, if you will, of audio product. We're anxious to get it out and into the hands of users for useful feedback.
Well, we definitely appreciate
I'm sorry, Stephen. So if you can see from the campaign, there's about 110 users that are going to be in this initial group of beta testers. So it's a little larger than your average Indiegogo campaign. So people on average are spending about $1,200 between the two devices.
Right, and the good thing is you're actually showing production of it in some of the pictures, like the heat sinks, the guy soldering and building it, and here's one of, you know, listening to it. There's a lot of effort. Why don't you tell people what it took to really design this and create it?
Okay, well, there's largely two efforts. I mean, there's one which is to build an analog, sufficiently good analog system such that a vinyl purist, a vinyl enthusiast would want to take the step of digitizing vinyl and removing clicks and pops and doing all the metadata lookup. So we have an excellent team of analog designers who we've been working with for quite some time to produce it. We've got computer software people who are very good at digital fingerprinting, metadata, Linux. So we have a couple gigahertz Intel CPU inside of our box that does all this heavy duty math processing to non-destructively be able to move clicks and pops in real time, do all the lookups. We also have a web server that the Sugar Cube connects to look up the metadata. So it comes down to us. We have a million album LP database with artwork. So when we figure out what the song and the artist is using fingerprinting, going out to cloud services, we then determine out of multiple song lineups what the album is, and we you know, a link into our database. And that database was built over many years by Leo. And then we did a mass scrape of the internet to get a more complete library.
And that's a lot of effort. I mean, it really is.
Some idea. Right. And then you have to add into it, we have a mobile app, we have an iOS app, we have an Android app. They control the devices. The devices are made so that you don't have to have an app to control it, but you can put it on your stack. We have a stack behind us. I don't know if you can see it too well, but it's basically an integrated power amp with an integrated phono stage in it. We have a turntable, which is a Riga. So this is a very modest setup.
Middle of the road.
Middle of the road. Yeah, and we have a Sugar Cube SC2 and a Sugar Cube SD1. We've been doing playback and record demos for people. Last night we went out to Las Vegas, up the strip, and we got went to a really cool used record store, and we picked up a bunch of $2 or $3 records, which normally you wouldn't listen to because the clicks and pops are so bad, but they're beautiful records anyway. And we're demoing like a James Taylor album.
Nice.
This gives you an idea of the artwork. I don't know if you can see it.
Yep.
But you can see a catalog number. There's the actual artwork for the album, side A, side B. And I don't know if the audio is good enough if you want a demo of that, but that's
no,
basically.
Unfortunately, then you get the copyright people after you, and I've been warned once or twice. Yeah, those copyright people are like, they're fierce.
Yeah, no, and absolutely, and that's a very, really good intro to one of the main tenets of this is, what we said was we were working to get a license to do high-res downloads of these really pristine vinyl recordings we had, because many times the vinyl recordings will be better than master tapes and HD downloads that you can get online of from studios. And so we worked with the studios and Universal in particular to get a license, and then it just took so long and it was getting to be a very drawn out thing. We spent a bunch of money doing this.
I would like to clarify one really important comment about that. What we've discovered when you remove the noise with our process, it has no impact on the sonic quality of the recording. You can't, with careful A/B testing, you cannot hear the effect of our process. It just clicks and pops go away. We don't actually use what a traditional digital signal processing approach, which would involve filters and special, peak limiters or peak detectors, et cetera. It's an entirely time-based. It's so effective that when the clicks and pops go away, it sounds like you're listening to the studio master.
Nice.
There's just no noise. And what Dan was referring to is classic rock, the great jazz of the 50s, 60s, and into the 70s, classical music. The tape that these vinyl LPs were made from, the magnetic tape is frankly very mortal. If it's been sitting on a shelf for 20, 30, 40 years, it dies.
Oh,
and
no,
when
there's,
they make
there's,
a digital from it.
Yep, I don't believe consumers really know, but I've been in the recording studio and I'm very familiar with the tape, but some of the older formulations, and even if it's stored and the warehouse didn't burn down or got stolen, they have what they call baking the tape. You're literally taking the big master reel, big 2-inch, whatever, and it's thick, and you put it in an oven and you bake it. And sometimes it works out, sometimes you get flaking and separating of the magnetic material.
Precisely. So we were exactly the point. So that reissues of certain vinyl LPs have been spectacularly successful. For instance, the Masterworks of Duke Ellington released from Audio Productions.
Analog Productions.
It was incredible fidelity. One has to wonder, how did that tape survive perfectly? In other cases, not so. Things are clearly degraded and didn't come out as well. If you can get an original pressing, which you find in the used record store, and you play it through our box, it sounds like a early pressing fresh out of the wrapper.
So, for instance, this James Taylor album we bought last night cost $2. And it's an earlier pressing. It sounds excellent. When you listen to it, with clicks and pops, it's you don't want to listen to it. That's why it was $2.
But with your device clicks that removes it.
Yeah, go ahead.
With your device, it removes all that and makes it sound pristine.
Right, correct. And to bring up the point about the copyrights, every album that was produced and still produced contains a worldwide license to use it and for your own personal use and to make your own copy of it and to make a digital copy and to use the artwork and make a copy for your own collection.
Right.
So the idea is, instead of us going and asking and for the painful process of getting every recording cleared and then selling it online, let's enable people, you know, do it themselves.
Exactly. Well, thank you. Anything else you'd like to inform our viewers?
Just enjoy the music.
And that's a perfect segue. And let me just run your titles one more time. That was Dan and Leo with SweetVinyl. They have an Indiegogo. If you go to Indiegogo, look up Sugar Cube or SweetVinyl, you'll find it right there. Great unit, removes the ticks and pops, will make your vinyl sound really great. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thanks, Stephen.
Thank you very much. I'm going to bring the camera right back to me. Let me do that. Hi, everyone. I'm Steve Rockin with enjoythemusic.com and enjoythemusic.tv. As always, in the end, what really matters is that you enjoy the music. So let me go ahead and play some music for you guys.